machine in Python. Along with it, we are going to see case studies of our previous day session by our condenser. First, we are going to discuss what is machine learning. As many authors suggest many definitions by themselves, I just took idea from Herbert Alexander Simon's definition, who received a Turing Award and one Nobel Prize award. What he stated that is, learning is any process by which a system improves the performance from the experience. That is, we human can gain experience what we learn in our real-time applications. From that, he concluded that machine learning is concerned with the computer programs that automatically improve the performance through experience. That is, machine learning is a system which is going to predict the results based on the previous experience what it gains. This is nothing but a short introduction about machine learning. And some of the authors says that develop the systems that can automatically adapt and customize themselves to individual users. In many applications, machine learning helps to customize a user's profile and the users, based on the user interest, it is going to predict some results. Whereas in some applications, develop systems that are too difficult, expensive to construct manually because they require specific detailed skills or knowledge turned to a specific task. That is, in some system, we can't able to build a system that particular applications. It may be cost effective or it may be difficult. Whereas in that situation, machine learning helps us to provide a model to predict the output based on the previous results. So next we move on to why machine learning? Machine learning is available in day-to-day life applications. Many of the users may understand that these are running in machine learning application, but some of the author doesn't know that these applications run in machine learning. But we as a faculty or students under computer science engineering must know and realize that many applications in our day-to-day life belongs to machine learning applications. And second thing, increasing computational power. Increasing computational power is nothing but we are in a need to compute the result in a high manner. That is, we have to produce the result quickly and the result must be in an accurate manner. And the first thing, flood of available data, especially with the advent of the internet. This is nothing but we are running many programs in the internet only. Even a small child can able to work on a smartphone, tablet, everything. So we humans depend on the internet. Hence, the usage of data will be high in day-to-day life applications. The major example for this is, first one, increase in the data. In our day-to-day life applications, we use Netflix, Amazon, that is for online shopping, everything. I just tell you a real example here. We people, while in our school days, if you want to learn anything, if you want to know the meaning of a word, what we do, we just refer a dictionary. We always use dictionary to refer a meaning for that word. Else we may ask our friend, our teacher, our parent, anything. But we all have our dictionary in our shelf, right? But in today's life, we also didn't use the dictionary. We just move on to the Google and search the word and we want to know the meaning for that word. Also, we use a Google assistant, a voice assistant, to know the meaning for the word. So to refer dictionary, we need a hard copy of the dictionary, but we didn't know that. So this is the major reason for the flood of available data, especially in the internet. So increasing computational power, just now we discussed. So on the third one, growing progress in available algorithms and the theory developed by the researchers. That is, we We the people are very much interested to know the new things, and if a new domain machine learning comes here, means what we do, we just search on the internet, we refer the algorithm, and we are applying this algorithm in our real-time applications. So this is also the main reason that is for the availability of data. Next one is the major is increasing support from the industries. This is nothing but many of the industries provide support for us to work in this platform. Simply, if you want to do anything, that is, if you want to know some output, means what we do in Google, we are available with the data set. That is, they are providing online platform for us to work on that specific domain. So these are the major reasons the machine learning is emerging now. So I just give you another idea. As we discussed in the previous slide, increasing in data because of we people using data on the internet. Second one is machine learning helps the user to solve the problem quickly. That is, the machine learning analyze the problem in a different manner and solve the problem quickly, which will be helpful for the user. Next one is uncover pattern in the data. That is, it is going to predict the output in a previous step itself, and it provides accurate results. These are the major reasons that why we are using machine learning nowadays. So yesterday itself we discussed that what are the major types of machine learning: supervised machine learning, unsupervised machine learning, reinforcement learning. Supervised, unsupervised, and reinforcement learning. Yesterday itself we discussed all these algorithms. So I just give you a quick overview of what is this. So machine learning algorithms are of three types: supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and the reinforcement learning. Simply, supervised learning is nothing but which is a trained set. We are just going to predict the output. Whereas in unsupervised learning, we are going to cluster the group of data. In the reinforcement learning, it is a hit and trial method. So support vector machine comes under supervised learning. Hence, I just give you an overview for supervised learning. Supervised learning is nothing but considering this example. Consider the learning is guided by a teacher. We have a data set which acts as a teacher, and the role is to train the model or the machine. Once the model gets trained, it can start making a prediction or decision when a new data is given to it. That is, considering this example in our real-time application, if we are a teacher, if we are going to the particular class continuously for 2 or 3 terms, we, the teacher, predict the result of the class. We can able to predict the result of the class for the particular subject or the overall result of that class, and we can able to predict whether the student can pass in our subject or not. This is nothing but supervised learning. That is, the teacher can able to predict the students in the class. Also, we can able to identify each student based on their characteristics. This is nothing but supervised learning. Here I'm just giving the supervised learning model. Considering in the first figure, this is considering the image which is shown in upper. First of all, we are going to design a model. This is nothing but our trained model. In which way we are going to design this model, we are going to provide an previous past experience as input to this model. That is, we are considering Apple as example here. In this example, I have taken apple. The size of the apple may vary from smaller to larger. So to some extent it may be larger. So the color will be differ from little red to somewhat red. And it we are going to design a model the different types of apple. So in this model, if you given an input as apple, so considering here, if we given as input to apple to this trained model, it will predict that whether the input is the apple or not. This only supervised learning do. That is, if I'm giving apple as input to this model, not only these three apples, just we have considering this apple. So it will predict whether the given input is apple or not. Whereas see the figure given below, in unsupervised learning, it predicts that it just clustered the group of apples in one manner and banana in another manner. So this is nothing but supervised learning and unsupervised learning. But what the process in the supervised learning is, see this picture. First of all, we have to train a model. This is nothing but our model trained. We have to train the model based on the previous experiences as we learned. That is, if you are considering any fruit or any object, we have to train this model from their different varieties. So the here considering a tomato, we are just simply adding an input as tomato to this model by using some algorithm. We have to choose a specific algorithm to predict this output. And after processing, if we give an input that is tomato to this model, it will predict whether this is a tomato or not. If we give another input, it simply says that it is not a tomato. This is nothing but supervised learning. So how it works here is, as I said, first of all, we have to design a model. This is nothing but our training data, and this training data is given as input to the algorithm, and this algorithm is classified whether the given input belong to this particular model or not. So if you fed a new input to that algorithm, it classify whether the data belongs to the particular group or not. This is nothing but supervised learning. So where it is most where supervised learning is popular is, it is popular in many application. I just take only three applications. Advertisement popularity is, while we purchase anything in an online, we can simply see all those. If we purchase an order, it shows that if you bought this, we can also buy this also. Like that, it just advertises some other products based on our profile. That is what we have seen previously. Or if you purchase this, you can purchase like where in that supervised machine learning is working. And next one is spam classification. That is in our email, it classifies whether this is an message to us or it is moved to the spam. Like that, in face recognition, it can clearly identify our face and get acted as an authentication process. So that's all about supervised machine learning. Are you clear about supervised machine learning? So, we move on to our topic, support vector machine. Support vector machine comes under a supervised learning. In supervised learning, we have classification and regression. As ma'am discussed yesterday, the support vector machine covers both the classification and the regression algorithm to give an accurate result for both the classification and the regression algorithm. I just tell what is a classification. Classification is the process of assigning a class label to a particular item. That is, under a label, we are going to classify the different objects. This is nothing but classification. I just give you a real-time example. See this picture. If you are living in a gated community or in an apartment, in that we won't place all the dust in a single dustbin. In that apartment, if they keep the paper, metal, plastic, e-waste, glass and organic dustbin separately, we have to keep our wastages separately in these dustbins only. So this paper, metal, plastic or nothing but our class. Based on this class, we are going to organize our wastages. This is nothing but classification. So what is the definition for the support vector machine? SVO is a discriminative classifier that is formally designed by a separating hyperplane. SVM constructs a hyperplane or a set of hyperplanes in a high or infinite dimensional space, which can be used for classification or regression. Refer this figure. SVM is nothing but we are going to classify the object. That is, this blue line is our classifier. It is going to separate the objects. This is nothing but simply SVM. So what is the major objective of the SVM is to find a hyperplane in an n dimensional space, n the number of features that distinctly classify the data point. I just tell what is SVM in a clear manner in the next slide. Before getting into the SVM, first we have to know what is linearly separable data and non-linearly separable data. As we know, linear is nothing but objects in a sequence of lines we classify as linear. See in this figure, in the first figure, the green objects and the purple objects are separated by using a single line. Are you clear? That is, if I draw a line here, I can able to separate these objects into different classes. I can able to draw line here, here, or like that. This is nothing but linearly separable data. Whereas non-linearly separable data is nothing but I can't able to separate these pictures by using a single line. That is one or two lines. If I want to draw a line, I can't able to separate these objects clearly. If I draw a line here, so we can't able to separate these objects by using a single line, one or two lines. This is nothing but non-linearly separable data. So you got clear idea about a linearly and non-linearly separable data. Now I explain the SVM clearly. Considering this example, SVM is a supervised learning method that looks at data and sort into one of the two categories. See this image clearly. If you understand this picture, SVM will be very useful, very clear for you. See, first of all, in supervised learning, what we discuss is, first of all, we are going to train a model based on the previous experiences. The first system referred here is model training. This is nothing but our trained model. In this model, we are going to give an input. We are going to train this model based on apple and strawberry as our data sets. That is, the size of the apple may vary in different sizes. The size of the strawberry may vary in different sizes. We are going to take in the data set as apple and strawberry. That is two varieties of data. After training the data, we are going to predict this input. That is, considering here, if I am going to give an input to this model, it is going to predict whether the given object is apple or strawberry. So I am given a strawberry as input. It just classify that the given object is strawberry. The question here is, but how does the prediction work? We are simply saying that we are going to train a model with the two data set. We train the model. We are given input strawberry to this model. It is just predict that the given input is strawberry. So the question here is how it predicts the output. So the functioning of the support vector machine is explained clearly. First of all, we have to plot these data in our graph. That is, we trained a data set by using apples and strawberry. Considering this apples and strawberry as our data, just plotting these data in a graph, that is by measuring their attributes, either by the height or the weight, we just simply pointing these data in a graph. After pointing the data, we can clearly understood that The size of the apple or the weight of the apple may vary from the strawberry. So it appears in one side and the strawberry appears in another side. The second step here is, what is the function of SVM is, we have to draw a decision boundary line. This line is nothing but our decision boundary line. This line, after drawing this line, we are going to predict the given input is strawberry or apple. Listen here, if I draw a line like this, I see in the third picture, if we are given input, if you are given an input as a strawberry, if we plot the strawberry in this graph, we may get any point here. So if I get a point below the line, it is classified as strawberry. If I got a point above the line, it's classified as apple. After clearly getting this boundary line, we can able to predict whether the given data is apple or strawberry. This is nothing but our support vector machine. This decision boundary line is nothing but our hyperplane, a support vector machine classifier or decision boundary or hyperline. This line can be classified as many names. So have you all get a clear idea about this? Okay, now I move on to the kernel. Thank you. Considering another example, here I am taking an example that is a given a set of people with a different height and a different weight. That is, I am going to take a data set with the people of different heights and different weights. So I have taken a 5 female sample data set and 5 male sample data set. The height of the female varies from 174 centimeter to 185 centimeter, whereas the height of the male varies from 179 to 182 centimeter. So what is the first step of SVM is, first of all, we have to plot these data in a graph. After that, we have to draw a boundary line. So first, I am going to plot these data in a graph by using these data points, that is the height and the weight or the attributes I have taken here. Considering height as x-axis or y-axis and another attribute to the another axis. So I'm simply plotting this data point, that is if the height is 174, the weight is 65. That is, if the height is 174 and the weight is 65. Like this, we have to plot all these data points in a graph. After plotting this graph, we can clearly see that the female data points are available at the left side of the graph. Male data points are available at the right side of the graph. The next step here is, we have to add a new data point and we have to classify whether the new data point belongs to the male category or female category. So I'm going to consider a data point here. I need to classify whether this data point belongs to the male or female. How we classify? We have to draw a decision boundary line. So the main concept of the SVM is how we choose this decision boundary line. In this example, I will explain you clearly. We may draw not only a single line, by individually separating these data points, we can clearly draw any n number of lines. We can draw line here, line here, line here. I'm just draw 2 lines. So the objective of this SVM is, we have to choose the correct boundary line to get the correct result. That is our major objective. So if I considering this 2 line, we can split our data by choosing any of these line. Any one of the line can clearly split this data. But to predict the gender of the new data point, we should split the data in a best possible way. That is, I have to choose the optimal boundary line to get the correct input. How we choose a optimal line is, first of all, we have to identify an object which is outermost to the data set. I am just taking the line one as of my boundary line. See this image. If it is a group of people, in that people, this one is the point which is outermost to this data set. So I have to draw a line parallel to this hyperplane. We have to draw a line parallel to this hyperplane because this is the outermost, this is the maximum data closest to this hyperplane. Same like this, in this group of data set, that is in the female data set, we have to choose the outermost point which is closest to the hyperplane. So after choosing this point, this is the data which is very close to the hyperplane and which is maximum to the data set. So draw a line parallel to the hyperplane decision boundary line we have chosen. Next step is find the distance between these two lines, that is the line what we have drawn. Same, I'm just taken two lines, right? So the another line, as we found the, this is the data which is outermost to this data set, and draw a line, that is this orange line is our second boundary line. Draw a line parallel to this boundary line, and same, this is our maximum point in this data set. Draw a line parallel to our decision boundary line. Here measure the distance. Just compare these two distance, that is this distance and this distance. So which is the maximum distance? That is nothing but our decision boundary. In this line, the distance is smaller. In this line, we get the maximum distance. So I choose line one as our decision boundary line. So how we classified is, see this image. I have taken this image. These are the two points I have taken to find this decision boundary line. So this is nothing but our decision boundary line. This is the maximum distance we have got here. So in technical terms, this is our normal, we are saying these are the points, this is a line, this is a distance merging like that. So the support vector machine gives a technical word to this point. This is that is nothing but the point which we taken to draw the decision boundary line is nothing but our support vectors. These are nothing but our vector points. In support vector machine, this is considered as support vectors. This decision boundary line is nothing but our hyperplane. Hyperplane in two-dimensional, we say that this is our hyperline. In three-dimensional, we can say this is our hyperplane. Simply in SVM, we are saying this our hyperline. So this is the hyperline which separates the data into two objects. These are the support vectors. This is nothing but our decision boundary line, that is our hyperline. See, we got a new data point here. If we got a new data point here, we classify these data objects as male by using this decision boundary line. So this is nothing but the data belongs to the male group. Here, like this only, we have to classify. So, and the another concept is, the distance, that is this we consider this is our boundary line. So one side of the distance is considered as our d plus distance, that is the distance, the support vector which is closest to this boundary line, distance is considered as our d plus distance. The support vector which is closest to the negative point or which is somewhat maximum to that point is considered as our d minus distance. So the sum of the distance of the d plus and d minus is considered as our total distance margin to that to our support vector. So these are the basic concepts in a linear SVM. As I said, linear data objects is nothing but we are going to separate these data objects by using a single line. We can able to separate these data objects. So what are the major work here is we have to find the support vector. Support vectors is nothing but the support vectors are nothing but if we plan to separate these two data lines, which is the outermost point we taken is this as support vector. Outermost point to the opposite data set is considered as another support vector. We have to draw a boundary line between these two support vectors. Else, if we draw another step is if we draw a line, we may find the support vectors and find the maximum distance. We may do in either of the way. The first step is we may find the support vectors. And after finding the support vectors, we just find the midpoint between this, we can draw a line. This is one method. Whereas in another method, we may draw several lines. After drawing lines, we find the support vectors and we can find the we find the support vectors and based on the margins, which is the maximum margin, we can get our hyperplane. So that's all about linear support vector machine concepts. These are the basic concepts. So, but what happens if the hyperplane is not optimal? That is, if we choose a wrong hyperplane, what will be the output is, we have to be, in our example, we consider two hyperplanes, right? If this is this is the optimal hyperplane we choose, but if we choose the wrong hyperplane, that is the line to orange here means what is, we find a data point in a misclassification way. That is, if the new data point arrival here is, if we choose the hyperplane, this is our hyperplane, it misclassify as this belongs to the female data, but it is actually belongs to the male data. So the objective of the support vector machine, this what is the major objective is, we have to choose the correct hyperplane to predict the data accurately. This is our major objective. Do you all clear about what is hyperplane? Shall we move on to another topic? Okay, thank you. We move on to the next topic. After getting a clear idea on a decision boundary, that is our hyperplane, we got some more ideas on SVM clearly. So that this is a major concept in SVM. Okay, so far we have discussed about the linear data set. So this is nothing but example for the linear data set. Here I am taken a sample data set with the objects simply blue dots and the yellow dots. If this is a linear data set, we can simply draw a hyperplane by using some support vectors. We separate these data objects, right? So what if the data is not like this? This is linearly separable data. If the data is in a non-linearly separable, considering this is in a, these objects are in a one-dimensional data. So the sequence of objects, that is blue dots, after that yellow dot, and again we move to the blue dot. Here, how we draw a hyperplane? If we draw a hyperplane here, we can separate blue dots on our left hand side, whereas in the right hand side we have to classify both blue and the yellow dot. So the objects are not classified in a proper manner. So the kernel function in an SVM is introduced here. What is the objective or a function of the kernel is, transform the data. So in this first figure, the objects are available in a one-dimensional. So the function of the kernel is transform the data from one-dimensional into an another dimension. In other words, kernel is a function which is used to transform the data from lower dimensional into an higher dimensional data. That is, we transform from one-dimensional into two-dimensional, two-dimensional into three-dimensional. Likewise, we have to transform the data from data set or data from lower dimensional into an higher dimensional. See, in this example, if the data is like this, mean we can't able to separate this data by using a single hyperplane. So after transforming this data into another dimension, that is from one dimensional into two dimensional. See, I am just transforming this one dimensional data into one two dimensional data. If it is moved to another dimensional, I simply draw a hyperplane here. So I can able to separate this objects from another objects. For the transformation, we have some process I will explain in the next step. But first of all, we have to got a clear idea about what is kernel in SVM. So the kernel in SVM helps to transform the data from one dimensional into another dimensional, simply from lower dimensional into one higher dimensional data. This is a basic function of the kernel. After transformation, we can able to draw the hyperplane quickly. So now first we have taken the objects as one dimensional. We transformed into one two dimensional. This one dimensional data is now transformed into two dimensional data. What if the data will be like this? In this data, how to perform SVM for this type of data? If I draw a hyperline here, draw a line here, or draw a line here. So in this data, we can't able to draw a hyperplane in a proper manner. So again, same, we are using an kernel function. See this image. If I draw a hyperplane in any of these data set objects, I can't able to separate these data objects in a proper manner. See, if I draw any line here, I can't able to separate. So what we do here is, by using the kernel function, we can transform the two-dimensional data into an three-dimensional data. Have you see this image? We are transforming the two-dimensional image into one three-dimensional image. That is, using both x-axis, y-axis and z-axis coordinate, we are plotting these data points in a three-dimensional way. After plotting these data, we simply draw a hyperplane. In two-dimensional, we are saying as hyperline. In three-dimensional, we are saying this as hyperplane. See this figure. We are just going to draw a hyperplane here. After drawing the hyperplane, the objects will be on one of the objects will be available on upper side of the hyperplane. Another set of objects will be available on the lower side of the hyperplane. So this hyperplane separates the data objects into two categories. So the kernel function is helpful to transform the data. Hence, we obtain the hyperplane here. So these are some of the cases in a data set. See this image. The data are available in x-axis and minus x-axis, y-axis and minus y-axis. If the data are available, if the data are available like this, means what we do is, in some cases we may simply square the values in a negative side. If we square the values, if we square all these value, we just get a data set like this. After getting data set like this, we can draw a hyperplane. If it is not possible, we move this to the higher dimension to separate these data objects. Have you all clear what is the use of kernel here? So considering another example, simply in our real-time example, if a father and the child are moving to the zoo, means if the child asks whether this group belongs to the alligators or crocodile, how the father will differentiate is both the alligator and the crocodiles are similar, some characteristics may similar. So based on the size and the snout, we can able to classify the objects from crocodiles to alligator. So simply by using the data set, we can classify the data objects in one side and another in another side. This is our real-time example. So the, first of all, we have to find the support vector. Support vectors are nothing but outermost point to classify the boundary is nothing but our support vector. After finding the support vector, we have to draw a line. After drawing the decision boundary line, that is our hyperline, if a new data point appears on the here, it is classified as a crocodile or it is classified as opposite data object. This is our real-time example. So support vector machine works on many applications to classify the data objects. So what are the main concepts which comes under support vector machine is, the first one is we have to find the support vectors clearly. We have to identify the support vectors clearly. If we found the wrong support vectors, the entire problem will be wrong. And the next step is we have to find the optimal hyperplane. How to find the optimal hyperplane? By using the support vector. So if we choose the support vector correctly, we can draw the hyperplane correctly. So the maximum margin is a next step to identify the optimal hyperplane. And what will be the possibilities of error here is, when a misclassification occurs, it is because a given point is on the wrong side of separating the hyperplane. That is nothing but our classification error. So classification error is nothing but we simply neglect one data set on the opposite side. That for only one object and on the wrong side, means this is nothing but classification object. Margin error is nothing but we have chosen a wrong margin is nothing but our margin error. So the total error in the SVM is sum of the classification error and the marginal error is nothing but our total error. See this figure. In this figure, this is nothing but our marginal error. While drawing the hyperplane, or the data set are available in the margin. See, this is our margin, total distance margin. In this margin, both the data points are available in the margin itself. This is nothing but our margin error. Classification error is, in the second example, we classified these objects from these objects by using this hyperplane. After separating, only one data point is available on the opposite side. This is nothing but our classification error. So if we draw a line hyperplane like this, we may misclassify this object. So these are some of the data set available which leads to the error. So the next now we move on to the kernel concept. So considering this example, I'm just taken first example as one dimensional. See, in this one dimensional data set, I'm having only one characteristic, that is mass. Based on this mass, I'm going to classify whether these objects belongs to the obese or not obese. I just tell you shortly. So these red dots represent the objects which are not obese, and these red green dots are represents objects which are obese. So we have to classify by using the support vector. If I chosen this as our if I chosen this orange line as our hyperplane, what will be the prediction is, I choose this our hyperplane, if a new data point arrives here, that is in this figure we can clearly identify that if the entering new data object have high mass, it belongs to these obese objects. If it has low mass, it belongs to not obese objects. So if the new data point arrives here, simply we can know that this has higher mass, so this can be classified as obese. So if the data point arrives here, we can classify that this is the data or new data point belongs to the obese, because it is right-hand side, that is after the hyperline, it appears. So we can classify this object which is belongs to the obese. But the problem here is, if I have chosen this as our wrong support vector classifier, see, these are the objects which have lower density. In this objects, which this our new data point is very much close to this objects which are not obese. So we can classify this as are not obese. But if we have chosen a wrong data point, so by using this hyperplane, we can classify this as objects which belongs to the obese. So what the problem is, we choose the wrong hyperplane. So we are considering these two as our support vectors, and we have to draw the decision boundary line, that is our hyperline. So if the new observation falls here, means it belongs to this object, that is the objects which are not obese. So if we choose a wrong hyperplane, it clearly identifies that these are the objects which are very close to new data point. So how it will be occurring on the opposite side. So while choosing the hyperplane, we have to be very careful. And another concept is, as we discussed in the error diagram, we may have some data set. In few data set, we may have some objects which is very close to the data point. In that, we have to draw the hyperplane here only. After this point, the objects will be classified into one another object. So if we have the margin like this, this margin is nothing but our maximal margin classifier. This is considered as our maximal margin classifier, because after the long gap, we are having a long gap here, but after the ending of this support vector, we have only few space to draw to find the margin. This is nothing but our maximal marginal classifier. So like this, these are the major concepts in one dimensional, whereas in the two dimensional, considering mass as our x coordinate and the height as our y coordinate, I'm just simply drawing these data points in a graph. What is our first step is, we have to draw a hyperline. That as I already said, hyperline is nothing but the support vector classifier, that is we are classifying the data objects. So in two dimensional, we are saying this our hyperline. So I have to separate by using a hyperline. In this example, this is our support. We have to choose this our support vector and this our support vector. If I choose these two as our support vector and draw a hyperline, these objects cannot be separated clearly. So I just left this object and choosing this as our hyperline and this as our support, these two points as our support vectors, and draw a hyperline. So this is also another case, that is, if any one point is misclassified, which is misclassified, and it appears in the marginal part itself. This is nothing but our soft margin. So in one dimensional, we have seen that this is a maximal margin classifier. In two dimensional, the concept is, if a data point appears on the margin, it is a soft margin. And whereas these objects are transformed into a three dimensional by using mass, height and age. As we know, the age of the human increase, the height of the human is also increased. So the red dot, the first object will be the higher, and it goes, if the age becomes lower, the height and the weight also becomes lower. In this kind of data objects, we can't able to separate by using a single line. So after you because by using the kernel function, we use a hyperplane. See this, we draw a hyperplane here. So the green data objects are below the hyperplane, the red data objects are above the hyperplane. So using kernel function, we are classifying the data objects. So this is our last case study. This is considering as our dosages given by the medicine given for by a doctor to cure a particular disease. First of all, I have taken this example in a one dimensional. See, the green dots are the represents a patient who were cured by the disease based on the dosage given, and the red dot represents the patients who were not cured to the particular disease based on this dosages. This figure simply implies that the patient will be cured if we provide the dosage in a correct manner, correct way. If the dosage is too low, the patient will not be cured from the disease. Whereas if the dosage is too high, the patient will not be cured from the disease. If we give in a proper manner, the patient will be cured. So the problem here is this is a non-linearly separable data. This is a non-linear data. The problem here is if we draw a hyperplane here or here, we can't able to separate these data objects in a clear manner. So what we do is we are going to transform the data from one dimensional into another dimensional. That is, we are using the kernel function to transform the data from one dimensional into another dimensional. So the x-axis coordinates are the previous data set we have taken. We are going to move the data from two dimensional. We are simply squaring the values of data available in an x-axis to plot this data in a two dimensional. That is, the value of the first point is, if it is 0.5, simply squaring the value, it is 0.25. So just simply plotting all these points, we can get the data like this only. So after transforming the data, we can able to draw a hyper line. So as I said that in two dimensional, we draw a hyper line. This is nothing but our support vector classifier. So what we said, the green dot are the patients who were cleared by the dosages given. The red dot are the patients who were not cleared. So if we draw a hyperplane, below the hyperline, the patients who were cleared will be appear. Above the hyperline, the patients who were not cleared. So in two dimension, we can say that either in the left hand side or on the right hand side. So this is our trained data model. I chosen a support vector classifier. See, if a new data point arrives here, what we done in the previous step, we are going to simply square these data value. See the next image. If I square these data value, it comes to the portion the patients who were not cleared. So simply the new data point says that this patient will not be cured. So considering another data point, if we square this, the data point will be here when you see the next image. So this is a new data point who got cleared from the disease. So what are the main ideas in SVM is, first of all, we have to plot the data points in an lower dimensional. In this example, we have taken one dimensional. The next step is, by using the kernel function, we are transforming the data from one dimensional into another dimensional, that is higher dimensional, by using the support, by using the kernel functions. So what are the major concepts here is, we have to find the support vector and the hyperplane and margin are the importance. Simply we are setting kernel. There are nearly 8 types of kernels available. As the time is running out, I am just explaining 2 kernels in theory part, polynomial kernel and the radial kernel. Polynomial kernel is helpful for separating the linear data set. That is, it just transform the data from one dimensional to another. If dimensional 1 to dimensional 2, dimensional 2 to dimensional 3, like that. The parameters here is A, the polynomial kernel formula is A cross B plus R the whole power D. That is, A, B, R and D are the parameters. That is, A and that if I'm going to find the relationship between these two data points, referring these two data points, A and B is nothing but the observations on the points. R is the coefficient of the polynomial. D is the degree of the polynomial. Degree is nothing but whether it is one-dimensional, two-dimensional or three-dimensional. So polynomial kernel is helpful for separating the data objects which are in linear. Or B, this is a formula. We are just simplifying this formula. By expanding this formula, we can get this dot product. After getting this dot products, if you want to know the relationship between these two data products, the first A refers to the point on the x-axis, and the second point refers to the point on the y-axis, and the third point refers to the point on the z axis. Simply substituting the values of a, b, a square and b square, we can get the final output. Next one is nothing but a radial kernel. Radial kernel will be applicable for the data set which is available in a non-linear model. So the equation for the radial kernel is ae power minus of gamma into a minus b the whole square. This is nothing but the major function of the radial kernel is radial basis kernel able to work on infinite definitions, because we can able to move the data from one dimensional to two dimensional, two dimensional to three dimensional. If it moves beyond many dimensions, that is the attributes, we are having n number of attributes which is practically impossible for us to draw in a graph. At that time we are using the radial basis kernel. The basic behavior of the radial basis kernel is, considering this example, it just acts as the weighted nearest neighbor model. That is, if a new data set arrives here, is it just act based on the objects which is very close to it. This is the major working of a radial basis kernel. But it uses a formula for radial basis kernel. The parameters, as we discussed earlier, a, b are the different parameters on the points, and gamma is a relationship between two coordinates. The major term here under SVM is kernel trick. The kernel trick is nothing but calculating the higher dimensional relationship without actually transforming the data to one higher dimensional is nothing but our kernel trick. Simply, if you want to transfer the data from one dimension to another dimension, there is no need to draw a graph or there is no need to plot data points like this. The kernel trick helps us to simply pointing this data and we get the value. So the objective of the major objective of the SVM is we are using the kernel function. So now we came to an end of the session. What are the major applications of SVM? I have taken only few examples. The first one is nothing but a face detection. SVM are capable of classifying the images of a person in an environment by creating a square box that separates the face from the rest. That is, we are using in our day-to-day life application to unlock our mobile phone, laptop, everything. This square is nothing but our support vector classifier, that is our hyperplane or hyperline and everything. We are using in our day-to-day life applications. These are the applications available in Android version: face lock, true key, find face and face detection. And the next major application is text and hypertext categorization. So while we are searching any document, support vector machine helps to classify the objects search as text and hypertext classification. Text categorization is, it is going to classify the wordings in on one side and the pictures and text on the another side. So if we want to download a text file, it will be very easy to download, whereas the hypertext will be taken some more data. So a support vector machine helps to classify the text and the hypertext. And the next major application is bioinformatics. Bioinformatics is nothing but support vector machine. As we know that support vector machine helps to classify a boundary line. So for in our human body, for every parameters we are using, we are having some range point, that is for the pressure, normal pressure, high pressure, low pressure. So the support vector machine has a line, that is if the pressure is beyond the line, it is considered as high pressure, low pressure. So for the sugar, it ranges from normal sugar, the value which changes from beyond the support vector classifier. And the next one is support vector machine helps to recognize the handwritten characters. See, in first figure, just simply seeing, we can't able to find this as 4. So in very old documents or some older documents, if you want to recover anything, means this application helps to find out the handwriting recognition character clearly. And in most of the cases in real-time applications, the signature and the documents may be stolen. So if we use a handwritten recognition documents to identify whether there is a mistake occur here or not. And the major in our and the next example email spam classification, that is just designed a model based on the previous experience. The model designed whether this message is a spam or not, and after getting an inbox to our mail, it just classify this is a spam mail or not spam mail. What are the advantages of SVM? Is the major advantages we are using the kernel function, which helps to move from lower dimension to the another dimension. We can able to work on a variety of documents, past document, and we are only using few parameters a, b, r, b and gamma. These are the few values we are working. That's all. We came to an end of the session. If you have any queries, just post in the chat box. Yes, sir. Amrit Kumar, sir, you are asked that how to decide which kernel function to be used in different situation. Sir, if the data is in linearly separable data, we are working on linearly separable data, we use for polynomial kernel function. If it is not able to separate in a proper manner, that is non-linearly separable data, means we move on to RBF kernel. So this is a major part to select the kernel. Amrit Kumar sir, did you clear? Sure, we will provide a recorded link at the day 3, no problem. Why we need to transform data from one dimensional to another dimension? Transform data from one dimension to another dimension. So if you want, that is, if the data cannot be separated by using a single line, we must need to transform the data from one dimensional to another dimension. See, Arun, I will explain this using see, if the data is available like this, means how we classify, if we transform from one dimensional, two dimensional into three dimensional, we can clearly draw a hyper plane here. So after transforming the data, we can clearly separate the data objects into two discrete sets. Are you clear, Arun? From Sudhanya, ma'am, please let you explain RBF kernel and Pomanka. So our polynomial kernel will be helpful for the linearly separable data. It works only on it works good only on linearly separable data, whereas RBF kernel helpful in a non-linearly separable data, as this figure is an example for this question too. That is, if the data set is like this, means we can't able to separate by using a single line. So we transform this data into three-dimensional, we can clearly draw a hyperplane. Whereas in one-dimensional, if we can't able to draw a line in one-dimensional, if the data set is like this, means we can't able to draw a hyperplane here. So in this example, we draw a hyperline here. These are the basic concept under linear, non-linear, everything. Yes, sir. Now we move on to hands-on session. Thank you, participants. Thank you for your patient listening. I thank the Department of Computer Science Engineering for giving me an opportunity to act as a resource person for this wonderful workshop. Now let's move on to the hands-on session using Python. Ma'am, nane solittuma. The recorded session will be given in a group. As a coordinator, I will post all the recorded session in a group tomorrow. Any difference the algorithm which we are using from machine learning to data mining algorithm? Sir, it differs from the algorithm we are using, sir. Vanilla, malicious. It is based on the concept what we are using. Thank you, participants. Now I hand over the session to the administrator.
Thank you, Mrs. Divya, for your valuable session.
1 minute, ma'am.
Thank you, Divya, for your valuable session. We all got clear idea about support vector machines. Next, I introduce the resource person, Mr. M. Kannan, Assistant Professor, Arasu Engineering College, Kumbakonam. He completed BTech in Arasu Engineering College, Kumbakonam. He did his PG in Anna University of Technology, Trichy. He pursuing research work in the area of machine learning with cloud-based IoT at Annamalai University, Chidambaram. Overall, 9 years of teaching in Arasu Engineering College. He worked as a research assistant in Provost Project Evaluation of Sansad Adarsh Gram Yojana under the University of Mysuru and Ministry of Rural Development, New Delhi. Being as Executive Director of Divam Solution, Research and Development Center. Expertise in the area of image processing using MATLAB, data analytics using Python and R, wireless networks using NS2. Having the skill set of WPF and MVC architecture using C#, Android app development using J2ME and Python. Having the copyrights of enterprise applications for the academic and trade center management. As a corporate trainer, hands-on training given in an assortment of technologies as said in the skills set for various colleges. Now, I hand over the session to Mr. M. Kannan.
Okay, good afternoon to one and all gathered here. We will go with the hands-on practice on Jupyter environment. First of all, what is Jupyter environment? I don't want to bore you with the presentations like this all. First, we go with the directly go with the Jupyter environment. Jupyter is an environment for Python-based programming things. We can able to install this by means of Anaconda. If you install the Anaconda versions, it will ask the options of environments like IPython, Jupyter, and Spyder like that. If you select the Jupyter, means it will launch it into your system. You can avail by means of the command prompt. Go with the command prompt and type Jupyter notebook itself. It will be shown like this environment. I think you can all see my window. There is an environment. This is nothing but a Jupyter tree structure. I go with the desktop and taking the exercise for today's session. And before that, COVID-19 data analysis is a major topic. 2 days, a lot of most of the participants asking about that, why we go for the COVID-19 data sets. These are things. First of all, I would like to answer for the question, why we go for COVID-19 data set? Because in this research area, most of the requirements are there, most of the research things are there, and most of the research problems are there. We may address means it will be easy to give some solutions to this pandemic situation. That's why most of the people are go with the COVID-19 data sets. And I would like to show the COVID-19 data sets first. And the main thing is, I have two data sets for that. The first one is a COVID-19 patient data set from my own creation, and COVID data from the data world. And I will explain with my creation. This is a COVID-19 data set. If we are going to analyze the target means this is infected or not, by means of the symptoms, fever and throat infection and breathing issue, our blood pressure, insulin, BMI, diabetes are considered. These are should be considered for further processes, like the patient going for the patient in the condition of normal state or going to the highly infected state. These are used for that. For that only, but basic things are fever, throat infection, breathing issues. These are the basic parameters required for that. And this is COVID data set. And next one is COVID data. This is nothing but these are the data collected from the continental and the different countries. This can be separated by means of country-wise and date-wise. Data are separated. We have a lot of data here from Asia to the all the continents, and the data name should be like this: first, total cases affected, new cases, and total deaths, new deaths, and totals. These are the data are there, and our target data is life expectancy. These are the target data. And same like that, age 65, age 70, and GDP, cardiovascular diseases, diabetes, females, males. These are the details out there. We will go for the data sets using this programming by using this data sets also. First, we go with the coding part. I like to introduce the Jupyter environment first. I think so many of them having aware about the Jupyter environment. But I like to just give some how to work with the Jupyter environment. It's enough for this session, because I don't want to waste the time with the Jupyter environment. First one, how to work with Jupyter environment first. It should be started by means of this framework. And I'm going to open or open a file by using dimred like that. Or else I'm going to create a new file. New Python. Yes, this is a Jupyter environment. Now I'm going to use here. You are all well known about that. Print welcome to this environment. I'm going to run by means of this. Okay, welcome to this environment. I'm going to give some error, syntax errors like that. Yes, it's displayed with the syntax error. File, what's the file name is? Line number one, welcome to the where it having some error. And the syntax it displays what is the error, name of the error, and syntax error and invalid syntax is there. This is the way of displaying the errors with the environment. And we can use the same like that in that normal programming. Okay, but why we are go for Jupiter? This is the main question. It can easy to adapt with the data sets. It is easy to use with the data sets, data frames or like. If we are go with the data sets or data frames, it is convenient to us to work with the Jupyter environment. And it can adopt the containers, like you know well about the containers, Docker, and these containers are very useful, very adaptable with the Jupyter environment. That's why we go with the Jupyter environment like that. And now I'm going to the exercise. Just I'm going to start with dimensionality reduction. Before that, I would like to read the file first. Okay, then I'm going to read the data set first. For reading the data set, I need a system. Semicolon is mandatory. Should we do along with you? Yes, you can do along with you, but you can able you can Prasad Krishnamurthy sir, you can cannot able to follow me. That's why Arun Kumar sir, I will give you data sheet surely to you. You can work with, and I will give you the recorder session with you. You may work with along with the recorder session. It will be easy. That is good for understanding the language and practice. So please follow with me, and we will work with by means of your own the system with the help of your session recording. And semicolon is mandatory. Yes, semicolon is mandatory when we go with the some of the statements like that. If it work with the functions, if it work with the data structures or data frames like that, it no need to give the semicolon. Some of the statements only require semicolon itself. Okay, then we go the code. Yes, the environment is separated by lines. Line by line implementation and running is easy to capture. And can we work on PyCharm environment? Yes, we can work with the PyCharm environment, but I'm using the Jupyter environment. We can work with the IPython, even we can work with the Spider environment, but environment is different. The language is same, environment is different. Why I familiarized with the Jupyter environment? Jupyter environment is very easy to work. That's why I'm choosing that. Okay, Anita ma'am. Import pandas as PD and import NumPy as NP. I will answer to the questions at final. First I will complete the session first. Import pandas as PD, and pandas is used to read the files. This is like the namespaces. And numerical Python, you well know about that NumPy. NumPy is used to give the numerical operation functions are there. The predefined functions are defined in that pandas and NumPy and SciPy. These are the namespaces used. We can import, we can avail the functions like that. For example, read CSV is a function. It is predefined in the pandas namespace. We can add it to the environment by means of import pandas as PD. I'm going to read the dataset by means of dataset equal to pd dot read csv of COVID-19 patient data dot csv. We can read the data, and we display it by means of the head function is used to display the dataset. Here the dataset is displayed with the numbers, and I'm going to describe the dataset first. This is head is used to only to used to what are the contents of the it only display the contents, but the describe is different. Describe is nothing but it gives the parameters like count, number of count is there, and mean value, and standard deviation value, minimum value, and maximum value, and 25% of value having that average, and 50% of average, and 75% of average. These types of description can be obtained by means of print of dataset dot describe of. And we are using this function here. Data set at I location semicolon comma 0 is to 8, and 8 is nothing but to display like this only. And this data set is only numerical values are there. If it is also separated in the file, I already shown it to you. this is already separated. If the value is not already separated, or it may be in the comma segmented values like that, it can be used. I will like to show. This is a data set for wine quality white data set. This data set contains the comma segmented values, or the separated values are there. It will be separated by means of the semicolon. This value can be read by means of removing the semicolons itself and using the code wine data equal to the same pandas data namespace is used here, and same function is used here, read CSV, and I'm going to read the file first, and I need to give the names, and after that I need to skip the first row because the first row is header value, so I need to the head section. I skip the first row, and after that I separate the value by means of semicolon. This is a way to separate the comma separated values, so that means CSV value, to the table tabular column, and I need to use the engine Python. This is the way to use the CSV, original CSV value, and we can you able to display by means of the wine data dot head of. This is another one example for CSV separation, and I go with the code again. I'm separate. I described the value. Data set can be described here. This is the way for reading the data set here, and I will go with the next. Next one. Next, we go with the dimensionality reduction. Dimensionality reduction. Yesterday you have seen the theoretical part of dimensionality reduction, principal component analysis, and what is the use of principal component analysis, how it works that, and I give a code for that. Now first I need to add the namespaces here, pandas and numpy, and I already told about that. I need to read the data set, and the data set should be converted at assigned as arrays. And after that I'm going to use the PCA here. PCA is principal component analysis. It can be obtained by means of the namespace sklearn.decomposition. This is also a type of assigning or calling the namespaces from anywhere from the program, and from by using the from keyword, from sklearn.decomposition import PCA. And I'm going to call the function PCA, and the number of components needed for to display the values extracted, feature extraction, so that I give the constant value 3, and after the getting the value, I'm going to fit the value to the fit command. Fit command is used to transform the value to print like structure. That fitted component values are printed here. After that I will go for the select k feature selection. So feature selection, I have used the chi square and select k best values are there, and using the function select k best score function equal to chi square value, chi square function. I used the chi square function. After that I print the precision. I using the precision value, I print the scores like this. This is the way of giving the dimensionality reduction. I aware about that. You are well known about the dimensional reduction yesterday, from the yesterday class itself. I don't want to repeat that. And we go with the classification programs. First, Navy Bayesian. Okay. First of all, the same like that. A Navy Bayesian classification need to read the content, and it should be pre-processed, because if the value having any null values or zeros values should be removed, and unwanted parameters should be dropped. These are the things should be pre-processed. After that we go with the training and test splitting value. That means we need to perform the classification by means of splitting the value training samples into the train and test samples. 75% are taken to training samples, and 30 or 25% is taken to the test sample, taken as test samples. And I'm using the matplot library for plotting the graphs, and seaborne is a namespace used to show the map of heat map. This is used for heat map, and this is a statement: PD dot read CSV COVID-19 patient data sets at CSV. Already I showed the data set. There is no transformation record because all are numerical. Already I shown here also data set at dot head of, and I'm going to split like that. Describe the value, and here, here the correlation can be identified, and it should be plotted like heat maps. The one the correlation between the parameters should be identified and calculated, and it should be displayed with the thermal heat map. And the next line is, yes, it is nothing bad. We need to pre-process by means of removing the zeros or removing the null values from the data set. I like to show the data set. This data set only having zero values itself, blood pressure zero, but that means it cannot be it is not predicted. That's why it is not obtained from the patients. That way it put on the zero. So, but here COVID data set having more number of null values are presented. Yes, more number of null values, more number of zeros are there. It should be reduced to get good accuracy value from the from our classification, so that we go for the zeros not accepted and the null value, removing the null value. And after that, feature extraction. I already told that feature extraction by means of a variance test code function is used here to obtain the feature value from the data set. Various threshold can be obtained through the sklearn dot feature selection. After that, I print the feature extracted value. The principal component analysis. You may use the principal component analysis or various threshold, whatever it may be. I have used here the variance threshold function. And now, I drop the diabetes pedigree function. There is no need for the classification. That's why I dropped, and the other values are assigned to the X. Then I selected the features by using the, I already told about the select K based feature selection method by using the T-square function. After that, I go with the training and test splitting function X. Now, the training and test split function gives the four values: X train value, X test value, Y train value, Y test value. From we need to get from the X value and Y value. After that, the random state can be zero. That means we may put also 0.25. That means the test value contains only 25% of data from the from the whole set. That's why the random set maybe should be with 0 or 0.30, 0.25, whatever may be. The test size is 0.20. And I go with the feature scaling technique to scale the data set to the transform the data set to the useful way. By using the standard scalar method. It is used for feature scaling. It can be obtained from the pre-processing sklearn dot pre-processing. After that, I will go for the classification. The new Bayesian classification is the function is what in the function in the name of Gaussian NB. Is the function name, and it can be obtained from the sklearn dot namespace. Sklearn is a namespace, and other than maybe packages or inner packages like that. Namespace is the inner packages, and the obtained classification value can be get please provide the code. Yes, sure, I will give the code and data set to you, surely. Gaussian, the classified value should be fitted to the classifier to get the prediction value. After that, we may get the score function, the evaluation metrics of that. I think you well known about the evaluation metrics, machine learning techniques in the evaluation metrics of machine learning techniques, the confusion matrix and score and accuracy. These are the evaluation metrics of classifier. I have used the confusion matrix to display how far it is trained and tested and obtained the F1 score and accuracy. So by means of naive Bayesian classification, we have obtained 68% of accuracy, 0.68. It is nothing but 68% of accuracy. We may compare with the SVM2 and by the same data set, we go with SVM. Yes. So clear about the naive Bayesian and SVM classification. There are two different classifications. There is no more number of differences are there. First of all, naive Bayesian is probabilistic and SVM is non-probabilistic. These are the this is a binary classification. This can be obtained by means of probability values. These are the different differences are there. But we will go with the code. Same like that, we need pandas, we need numpy, we need matplot library, and we need seaborn for a heat map, and we need to read the data by means of pandas dot pd dot read csv, read it, and the data set can be displayed, and after that we go with the correlation matrix calculation. The correlation matrix calculation can be obtained by means of data set dot correlation. This is the correlation matrix for the data set. And I'm going to set the target value here. The SVM can separate best for identifying the target values, so that I have used the target value y equal to data set dot target dot unique, and I'm giving the x values are fever, throat infection, breathing issue. These are the three major values used for the classification here, because other the values are used for the further identification and prediction of patients. But now I'm using fever, throat infection, breathing issue for x, assigning to the x value, and target is assigning to the y value. Same like that, I have splitting the value by means of the train test split function. After that, I go with the classifier SVC. Yes, SVC is nothing but support vector classification. It can be obtained from sklearn.svm. Then I explained here the classifier here. What are the parameters are there? We may get the parameters by means of setting the classifier, and what are the classifiers are there? What are the parameters are there? The parameters, the first we need to give the constant value, catchy size and class, and coefficient value, decision function, and main thing is kernel. Today's session, Mrs. Divya has give explanation about the kernel functions, kernel tricks. What are the kernel tricks are there? Some of the kernel tricks are linear, polynomial, and RBF, sigmoid. These are the kernel tricks are there. But here, the default kernel trick is RBF. We may set the other kernel tricks also by means of giving the parameters to the function. How do I give? I give from this. I will like to run from the start. Yes, it is displayed with the default value. We can change the kernel. Yes, the kernel is changed to linear. The default is RBF. It may be changed to linear by means of giving the parameters to the parameter to the SVC function. And probability is false, because SVC is cannot able to work with the probability. That's why probability equal to false. Then I'm going to fit the classifier values X train and Y train. Here, the future warning is given. Future warning is nothing but some of the parameters should be within the range itself. So that it should be displayed as future warnings. So gamma value should be explicitly to auto or scale. It need not to change the values. That's why it is displayed as future warning, and the SVC is fitted. After that, we identified the yes accuracy value. The accuracy for SVM is 70.77. Already we have a Naive here. Where is Naive? Yes. Accuracy value of Naive is 68.83, but accuracy value of SVM is 70.77. We go with the decision tree induction or random forest ensemble with the tomorrow sessions. It can be worked with. We can obtain more accuracy than compared with the SVM. These metrics are used to evaluate the classifier. Our classifier is good or not for this COVID-19 data sets. And we may work with the data sets here. And tomorrow we are going to explain with the decision tree induction and random forest ensemble and working with the data set OVID COVID data. I separated the data set for two sessions. First day we will work with COVID-19 patient data, and second day we will work with OVID COVID data set obtained from the data world. I will send the data set and the files to you, which is worked in today's session. What are the files? I'm going to send it are the data set file and demonstrated reduction file, and how to read the file, and after that SVC and Name. These are the files I'm going to give it to you today. Tomorrow we will have OVID COVID data and decision. OVID COVID data and decision tree data and random forest data, and after that finally we compare these three classification techniques: SVC, random forest, and decision tree. We will continue the session with tomorrow. After getting the accuracy, how do we check for a new data point? What is the prediction based on classifier obtained for a new data point? We need to give the new data point by means of changing the parameters with the SVC functions. We can change the parameter values and number of features and maximum depth. We can change by means of the depth value itself. And may I get the code? Yes, I told to you all. The code will be sent to your WhatsApp group today. I will give it to you. And can you explain RFE for feature selection? Sure. If you need for, we need to explain RFE for feature selection means, we will go with the RFE tomorrow. Don't worry. I will give you the code for the RFE also. Okay, thank you all. Thank you so much for this wonderful session. And I hand over the session to Mrs. Or Kaleshali ma'am for coordinating the completion of works. We can use other method for all processes. Please explain. Yes. Sorry. So do we need to check all algorithms and select the best? Yes, of course. All of the algorithms give the result, but we need to check the accuracy, which one is apt for our work. For example, if we go with SVM means only very small number of large data set means it will work. But if you go with large set of data sets, it won't work. So that's why we go for the random forest techniques. So based on our requirements, the algorithm should be changed. The algorithm should be picked by means of our requirements and the data set we have used. That is the main reason. And also not only for the classification techniques, all the techniques, whatever may be the feature extraction, feature selection, and what will be the technique, we should go with the data set and our problem. After that we may decide which algorithm is best, how to decide which algorithm is best fit for particular problem statement. Yes, that's why I'm told to you. First, we need to analyze. I'm going to classify or I'm going to predict, or else I'm going to give classification or prediction or regression for small number of data set or large number of data set. Maybe they having more number of impurities means we go with the SVM. It may be less number of impurities means we may go with the random forest like this. Large set means we may go with the random forest like that. Please provide code for random forest ensemble today itself along with others. Sure, I'm ready to give the random forest ensemble technique. I'm ready with the code, but we need not to start the random forest ensemble yet. We are going to give the explanation of random forest ensemble tomorrow itself. We will give the code tomorrow, so that by today itself we can check. Okay, I will give it to you surely. Jasila said, "I will give it to you the code. Don't worry. I'm ready with the code. I'm ready to give it the code. Random forest and decision tree. I will give it to you surely." Okay. Thank you all. Thank you so much. I hand over the session to our coordinator. Thank you so much.
Thank you for your valuable presentation and time to share to provide a hands-on session on these topics. Participants, thank you for your patience listening. Tomorrow we will have a decision tree and a random forest along with the case study. Tomorrow the program starts by 11 a.m. Tomorrow we will share a feedback link. You have to fill this feedback link. After 1 hour, we will provide each certificate to all through email. Thank you, participants.